I'm going to start off. I think reception is a good place to start to see where the children start off, where they're expected to get to by the end of reception. I think that will show really well where the children go from there. So I'll start off and then I'll hand over to Mrs. Wilkinson, and she'll tell you a little bit more about year one and year two, about the key stage one maths. Hi. Thank you. Okay, can I start off just talking a little bit about the expectations for the end of reception then for maths? So by the end of reception, children are expected to have a really good understanding of numbers to 20. That's not just counting to 20 or counting back from 20. That's knowing one more and one less than numbers to 20, doing addition and subtraction with numbers to 20, and also solving problems like doubling, halving and sharing using numbers to 20. So they need to know those numbers inside out, which is actually quite tricky because the teen numbers, we call them the tricky teens in reception, because they are the trickiest numbers in the number system. Once you get to 20, it starts following the same pattern again, 21, 22, 23, but those teen numbers don't make much sense to them. 15, 30, you know, it's the doesn't follow the same pattern as the rest of the number system. So we call them the tricky teens, and those are the ones that the children do struggle with a little bit more. So we go in depth into numbers to 20, we do lots of different things with them, and I'm going to talk a bit about what we do in school, and then I'll sort of share some ways that you can support your children at home in reception as well, just so they've got a really good base and a really good foundation for when they move into year one and two. Because if we miss things and have any gaps, that has a really big impact on what they do in year one and two. So I'll start off by just talking a little bit about what we do in school. This actually builds up as the year goes on, and by summertime it will be around half an hour. We're actually probably at about 15 minutes now. So they do a 15 minute math session in school every day. They then do a small group, we call it mini maths. They do a small group math session where the teacher focuses on exactly what that group of children need. So we group the children into small groups and we really focus on their next steps. And so we can play games or we do some teaching input focused on exactly what those children need, so that it's really specific. So they get those two sessions every day. They also have access to mathematics resources through the whole of activity time. And this is encouraged, the teachers and LSAs, they facilitate the activity time and ask children questions to develop their math skills in activity time. And we also encourage the use of mathematical vocabulary and concepts through play. Shakespeare and Leisure in reception is a lot about knowing the vocabulary of money, of time, and weight. So it's, yeah, we sort of try and use play, like role play situations. We sort of weigh the fruit and vegetables, and we sort of ask them what the time is. We use role playing games to introduce a lot of that mathematical language. And you can do things like that. I'll go on to it later at home by doing things like cooking. That introduces more mathematical vocabulary than you think when you're timing what time things have got to come out and weighing the ingredients. So that sort of thing helps. We also sing lots and lots of number songs, which I'm sure if you're parents or in reception, you've heard one of the really lovely number one math songs that we've been teaching the children. They do love them, and that really develops their vocabulary in maths as well. And that, because the first thing they need to learn is to count in order. So yeah, songs really help them to do that. We do follow the principles that Key Stage 1 are following. Key Stage 1 is doing Singapore Maths, and there's actually no such thing as Singapore Maths for reception children. It starts from year one. So what we've done in reception is we have taken the approach and we have planned our lessons around the approach that Singapore Maths takes. So what we do is we use the CPA approach, where we start with something concrete. So we have something like cubes, for them to look at first of all, something, you know, concrete in their hands. We use all sorts of things though. We can use toys, lots and lots of different things, like something they can actually see. So we start off with a concrete approach, then we go on to pictorial. That's usually on our interactive whiteboard screens, where there's a picture that represents that. And last but not least, we go on to abstract. abstract. So we'd do a lot of concrete and pictorial before we go on to the abstract of asking children to do things like, oh, what's 3 plus 2? Or, I mean, we've been looking at 1 more and 1 less, and now some children, you can just ask them, what is 1 more than 7? And they can think about it and know that that would be 8. But we've done a lot with cubes first and a lot with pictures on the board to get to the stage where they can just say 1 more or 1 less than a given number. So we follow that approach, which is a Singapore math approach.
And I'll talk about that in a bit more detail when I come to my board.
And rather than skipping ahead, you know, once children can count to 20, rather than skipping ahead and saying, oh, well, we're just going to go on and go to 50, 100, we then use the mastery approach. So rather than skipping ahead, we ask the children to apply that knowledge in lots of different ways. An example of that is when we were doing, we spent the time focusing on each individual number up to 10 when they first came in. Some children could already count to those numbers, they already recognised them, but we'd ask them to solve problems, so we'd give them some cues and say, how many different ways can you find 5? Or we'd use money and talk about 5p and the smaller coins and different ways of making 5p if children were able to do that at that time. So rather than skipping ahead, we really embed that knowledge in lots of different ways rather than just jumping ahead to larger numbers. The other thing we find as well that we like to focus on is with counting, lots of children are great at counting as long as they're starting at 1. So we're playing lots of games at the moment where we don't always start from 1 when we're counting. We play a game, they call it the treasure game. We play it in lots of different ways, but they have a pot of treasure in the middle, and somebody turns over a card, and we'd start at 4, and then we'd go around the circle, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and the person that gets to 20 gets a piece of treasure, and they get to choose the next card. So that's one example of a game that we play, so that when they're counting, they're not always starting from 1. So they learn the pattern of the numbers, but they need to know them well enough that whichever number you chose up to 20, they would know what comes next. And that can actually get quite tricky. They really need to embed that number, and not just counting on, we will then move on to counting back. So if we chose 7, counting back to 0. If we chose 18, again, counting back to 0. So it's quite tricky, and we have to embed that knowledge to 20 as much as we can. And then some ways of supporting your child at home really is what we're talking about, which is lots of counting, lots of those games, and as I said, not always starting from 0. And giving them lots of practical opportunities to count at home. And number recognition is a big one as well. Some children are really good at counting, but actually recognising the numbers and matching the numerals, that can be quite difficult. So spotting different numbers on the doors as you walk home, numbers in the environment, recognition is really important as well. We're doing lots of number formation this year as well. We're trying to make sure children are forming their numbers correctly. So that's something, if your child is really confident with recognising, counting, solving problems, then I'd say that a good place to go from there is number formation.
Absolutely. And, just to jump in, some of the things that Ms. Jacobs is talking about, by the time, the handouts that I've given you today, you'll see is the end of year 2 expectation. And it's a huge jump from reception to the end of year 2. And I'm going to talk about the new national curriculum in a minute. And if we don't start kind of, in receptions or teaching the key skills, then we find that there's gaps by the time we get to year 2 of what the children can do. And but now, because of the things we're putting in place, we can see the impact that it's having as we get to year 2. But it's a big jump.
An example of that is that number knowledge of being able to count on not starting from 1 helps them with adding by counting on them when
Absolutely.
They go into year 1 and 2. So they find it really hard to, if they're doing 7 out of 3, to do 7, 8, 9, 10 if they don't know what comes next after 7. So all of this counting we're doing and sort of helping the children with their addition and subtraction. Language is a really important thing at home as well. Vocabulary involved in that. So talking about more and less and using a wide range of vocabulary when you're talking about numbers will really help the children as well.
Fewer than.
Yeah.
Less than. But all those kind of words, because that obviously means subtract. It means that the number's getting smaller. But that's quite a concept that's quite hard to grasp.
Finding the difference between 2 numbers. There are lots of different ways of wording things other than just adding and taking away. Shapes as well. Shapes measure in FS is all about vocabulary. It's all about recognising shapes, naming them, talking about the different parts of the shape, and also with the rest of shape space. If we're talking about length, it's about longer, shorter, and using that comparative language. And then they'll go on then to how much longer and how much shorter as they go through the school. Lots and lots of language really helps with all areas of mathematics, and in reception, in particular, shape, space and measure is all about the language you use. So knowing the names of shapes, talking about things being heavy and light, longer and shorter, as I said, there are lots of practical things you can do with your children that are really good to help with that, like when you're paying in the shops and things as well, money. It's really important to have that vocabulary of money, which is difficult, I know, because a lot of us use our cards now, so I have to say I'm guilty, I've never had any cash on me, but it's just sort of giving children the opportunity to understand money and the cost of things, and using that language of how much, or I'm getting some change, that sort of thing will really help them with their maths as they go through the school. As I said, a lot about vocabulary in reception as well. The expectations, as I was saying about the expectations for being in reception, 1 to 20 is really important. Also, they need to be able to solve problems, so it does include things like doubling and halving, so that's where we'll be going next in reception, is using that sort of language, because that can be quite tricky as well.
Yeah, it is. I mean, the doubling, children tend to get that quicker, but again, the halving, because that's either your subtraction or your division, which is always the harder concept than addition and multiplication.
Okay. Does anyone have any questions about reception, about sort of the way you do anything in reception, or are there any reception parents with any questions about how they could help their children at home at all?
Is that where we could get the number fund song?
There are lots on YouTube. We have number fund songs at school, but those are, we've bought them and they're copyright, so we're not allowed to share them out, unfortunately. But there are lots of different things on YouTube that we enjoy using with the children as well. You get things like the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so, you know, like all the old nursery rhymes that we're counting in the health as well. Any other questions from reception parents? Okay, I'll hand over to Mrs. Wilkins, and then she'll talk about where we go from there.
Okay, so I'm just going to give you a bit of background to what we do in our school for Key Stage 1, how we teach maths, and why we've sort of changed our philosophy and the way we teach. Those of you who came to the workshop last year will have heard some of the things I'm going to talk about. Because it is still quite recent, I feel it's really valuable to let you know what it is that we're doing. So, why did we change sort of the way that we're teaching maths? Well, the new national curriculum came out in 2014, which is for basically from year one onwards. And in that, the expectations compared to the old one have risen, you know, quite substantially. So for example, a child in year six in the juniors is now expected to learn the content that was traditionally for years seven and eight. So already it's kind of like you're a year above or 2 years above in some sort of aspect. So obviously the effect that that had on what we were providing under the old national curriculum, you know, then had an impact. So we decided to use, the other thing with the new national curriculum, it's changed from, it used to be a focus on calculation and less on problem solving, which is what we call reasoning, and it's switched round. So the focus is now 60% is on reasoning and problem solving, and only 40% on calculation. So gone are the kind of, yes, they will still have a times table question, for example, at the end of Key Stage 1, but most of it will be how can they apply that to a problem-solving scenario. And so obviously we've had to kind of change the focus in how we teach, rather than just lots and lots of calculations of things. The other thing is that there are no longer levels. So traditionally, your child came out with a certain level, which had sub-levels, and you could really kind of have a kind of grade, if you like, that is no longer. So your child will be reported at the end of year one and year two as having met the expected standard, is working towards the expected standard or has exceeded the expected standard in mathematics. Obviously, we have a differentiation within those brackets because they're obviously very wide, and we track each child's progress and we know exactly where they are within that certain aspect. But obviously, in terms of the way it's presented, it's not as succinct as it used to be. The other thing is the children have to have more number sense. Now, what I mean by that is that they have to do a lot more mental calculation. They have to be able to see connections between number, and they need to be able to see the links, as Ms. Jacobs was saying earlier, between doubles and halves, between multiplication and division, and look at sort of number families. So it's more about teaching them that number fluency and having that greater sense of number and not just working with numbers to thousands. So, why Singapore Poor Maths? I'm just going to give you a brief explanation as to why we did that. Singapore traditionally never performed very well at maths, and in the 1980s, a study of I think it was about 26 countries, it was ranked about 16th in the world. And their government thought this wasn't good enough and decided to spend the next decade investing in research as to how to make their maths better. They had top mathematicians from around the country and education leaders, and they created a programme of study called Singapore Maths. In 2012, when they did their next kind of baseline, they came second and they were only outranked by China. And incidentally, the UK is 26th, or this is in 2015. So clearly we are lagging behind some of our other countries, and obviously we need to look at what are they doing that works, that we could transfer to what we're doing certainly in our school. So the key points, the sort of fundamental aspects of Singapore Maths is, as I said, about you having that number sense and fluency, having that real knowledge of what 20 means, you know, being able to count backwards, forwards, being able to know what the doubles and halves all within that is, being able to understand fractions of numbers within 20, all sorts of things without moving up to numbers, higher numbers. In year two, it's basically up to 100 anyway. We tend not to go over 100. The other thing is using concrete objects, as Mr. Jacobs said, that the children can physically hold and manipulate, as well as using pictures. The other key thing is mixed classes. Now, traditionally here, we've always done math sets. And when I first started here, we taught math sets, so we had sort of a high, middle, and children that needed more support. And obviously the more able children, you're working with thousands, for example. But there were, when actually we look at it, there were gaps in knowing that those numbers inside out and being able to, you know, really apply them to problem solving. And actually there's the Singapore Maths model, and from other research has shown that actually there isn't any evidence that this has an impact on children's learning. In mixed ability classes, more able children have an opportunity to support less able children by explaining in their own words key concepts. And actually I see it in my classroom all the time. I see children who perhaps haven't quite grasped a concept from me, but a child is showing them in their own words how to do things, and they get it. And it's that partnership of working together. And actually, it's important to see that children can explain their thinking. The amount of times I say to a child, well, how did you get that? How did you find that answer? Oh, it was just in my head. Or, oh, I just knew it. So, but how did you know? What's the process that you went through to get that answer? And that's really important, to be able to explain how you got it. And for children who maybe do need that extra support, what we found is that children who work in mixed classes, they're being exposed to the whole curriculum. They are being exposed to, you know, the year one or the year two curriculum. And just because they may find an aspect of maths difficult doesn't mean to say they find all of it difficult. And it's amazing that, you know, they continue to make progress and learn, but just at a differing rate. So mixed ability classes has made a huge impact here. So I've talked about practical problem solving. I'm going to give you some examples in a minute. And as I said, the focus is not on rote procedure. So it's not on being able to count 10, 20, 30, 40, but being able to start at, say, 24 and count in tens, 24, 34, 44. And that's where the children find it difficult to do it out of order, if you like, because they're, you know, they know their times table by going 1 times 2 is 2, 2 times 2 is 4. But then if they've got a problem where they've got to apply 6 times 4 or 6 times 2 or 9 times 2 out of the order, then it all, you know, then they find that really difficult. So by being, learning it inside out is the key to it. Working at the expected standard or are working at greater depth, these are the children that we give mastery kind of questions to, or we give them sort of mastery things to explore. This is, as I said, about being able to explain your thinking, being able to write a written explanation as to how you know why an answer equals a certain answer. Being able to come up with their own number problems. So we've been doing a lot of work on subtraction over the last couple of weeks, as well as all sorts of other things. And if a child can create their own number problem, their own word problem, based on what they've learned, that shows a real sort of mastery level, that they're able to apply things. So writing their own number problem to give to a friend to answer. Also being able to ask them open questions, you know, why doesn't that work? Or why does that work? You know, I don't always tell a child that they're right. Compare with your friend, you know, and they've got to do a lot of thinking for themselves as to why that would work. And being able to explain their thinking. I have got some slides at the end to give you some more examples on mastery. Oh, here's some more. So, for example, you know, there might be a question posed to them. So it does not matter what order you do an additional subtraction calculation in. Is this right? How do you know? So they've got to write an explanation as to what they know. I might put some questions up on the board that are wrong, or some are wrong, some are right. You know, and I might say, explain which one's right, or true or false. And they need to explain, oh, well, it's false because of... Because the actual answer is that, you know, so it's more in depth. And the one at the bottom, things like, how did you know that 12 times 5? They've got to circle which one it is and explain how they knew it was 60, and not just it's in the 5 times table. I would expect them to say, because a multiple of 5 ends in a 5 or a 0, and those other three numbers don't. So that's the kind of mastery thing, not just circling 60. Yeah, that's correct, but that's not explaining why the others aren't correct. Do you see what I mean? It's that sort of greater depth knowledge. So how we support children in at different sort of learning speeds. So we do still differentiate in the class. So some children will be getting sort of mastery questions, maybe working more independence. Other children will either be getting more support from an adult, or from a learning partner, or, for example, in year two, we are adding and subtracting two-digit to two-digit numbers. If some children are finding that difficult, but can still add two single-digit numbers together, well, then they can still add. So, you know, the concept of adding, they've got. So we're just giving them smaller numbers to support their understanding and to make them feel successful. And I think the key is that after every lesson, we want a child to have been able to achieve and to be able to think, yeah, I got that. Okay, it might be working at smaller numbers, but they're understanding the concept. And that's sort of one of the biggest things. And again, they have the resources that they can use. So we have out all the time resources for children, even if it's, you know, sort of more, you know, a more able child, because they still need to use things, manipulatives as we call them. So different things that we use all the time. We always use cubes. We always use, I forgot to bring them, they're in my classroom, but base 10, which I don't know if some children have spoken about. They're like towers of 10 and then ones. So we physically do addition and subtraction using those first. The children get to manipulate those before they then transfer that to maybe a picture, before they then do the abstract calculation of it. So they've gone through that process. So we do that not only in FS, but year one and year two as well. So the same principle is carried out throughout the year, so it's consistent. So hopefully, by the time the children get to year two, it's a constant reaffirmation of what they've already done, but just working at bigger numbers, really. We have things like this when we're doing counting in tens. We just have bundles of straws to get them to really understand that this represents 10, 20, 30, and so on. So, you know, we have things like this out and available to children all the time. So I think I'm going to show you now, at some point, and I know some of you will want to see this, is how we actually teach the crux of the strategies that we do. So Math No Problem always starts with a story of a new subject. And that could be anything like having some children up at the front and say, you know, I've been to the shop, and I bought four croissants, and we have sort of real life things, apples, bananas, whatever it is, to make it real life. And I think that's one of the biggest keys things as well. Everything starts with a problem solving story that the children then from then apply it to the abstract, rather than just giving them a calculation and go, okay, they can multiply or divide. So we'd start with a story. I might have two children out and say, you know, Ben went to the shops and bought some croissants. He wanted to share them equally between him and a friend. And then at that point, I'd pose the question to the children, saying, how many does each child get? And then the children would then either draw pictures on their whiteboards, or if they know the division sentence already, they would demonstrate that. But it's all about not getting the answers from me, exploring it, seeing the kind of visual. And from that, they would then use the cubes, and then ultimately into a division written sentence. So after we've done all that, some children then go on to use addition and subtraction, either using 100 squares, which we have in our classroom, or number lines. And these are great, and we use these and all the practical equipment as much as we can until at some point we need to start weaning the children off it. Because unfortunately, and I hate to say the dreaded S word that comes at the end of year two, but when it does come, the children are not allowed to use anything like this. So they have to have a written strategy or something that they can do without using 100 square or number line. So we have to wean them off this at some point. So I was going to show you the strategies that we use in year one as well. Although year one will still be principally using these kind of things. So I'll do a number line first of all. So if, for example, a child had this sum here, 25 add 8. Now, what we would assume is that children could do that on their fingers, but I'm just going to show you how we add a two-digit to a single digit. And what we would try and teach the children is to see a connection that they know that 8, and again, they would have done this in FS, 8 is made up of 5 and 3, so the 25 add 5 is 30 plus the 3. So it's having that, you know, so a child could actually do that mentally by year two is what we would expect. However, if a child needs to then draw their own number line, to, you know, to work it out, that's absolutely fine. So we would start off by putting the bigger number first, And then we would just count on jumps. So I would count on 8 jumps. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And I would label each of these just to really understand that I'm adding one each time. And then obviously I'd put the numbers under the jumps. Until I get my answer. Now, the problem with that is that children do tiny jumps and then they miss putting the numbers at the bottom of the jump. So it can be problematic, but it is a written method that, you know, if children get used to doing it from an early age, it's an acceptable method. Similarly, if you're adding a two-digit number, this time you've got to add the two tens. We obviously do a lot of work on place value. And what we find is that because you're counting now in tens from any given number, this is the stumbling block. Because the children have got to add on a 10, so they've got to add on 39 to 49, then another 10, and then the ones, until they get their answer. Is that okay about number lines? Just to sort of show you how we would progress from that. Now, maths no problem, teach it, addition and subtraction. I'll show you again with subtraction in a minute. But teach addition and subtraction using the column method, which I never used to teach until really the end of year two, traditionally, because they do that in the juniors. But because we do so much work now on place value in the autumn term, that actually a lot of children are accessing now the column and addition and subtraction. But it does require the children to have that really good understanding of place value. So I'll just show you that for those that want to see it. And I apologise, I'm sure you've all seen this before, but you know, it's just so that you can see how we're doing it in school. So we always start with the tens and the ones, we call it now, we don't call it units. And I'm going to do the ones that go over 10 because they're the hardest. So we start with the ones, and we would have done all of this practically with our base 10 equipment first. So they would have had lots of opportunity to manipulate all these numbers. So 7 ones and 5 ones, and again they would have counted the ones already and known that there are 12 ones, and they would have learned that 12 can't sit in the ones column. Because it's more than 10. So we carry the 110 over to the tens column, and we put the 2 in the ones, then we add the tens. And I know how I was taught traditionally was just to go 2, add 1, add 1. But it's to re-emphasise every time that it's 2 tens, add 1 10, add another 10, to keep reinforcing that. Have I done it wrong? So 2 tens and 1 ten is 3 tens. Okay. Sorry, I saw you looking at us. So that's column addition, and I'll show you quickly subtraction. So subtraction on another line. We found the easiest way. We used to teach it as finding the difference and counting on from the smaller number to the bigger number. But with that, what you're doing is essentially adding again. And children found that very difficult. So what we teach using a number line is by starting at the... If the children imagine the number line, you've got the biggest number now at this end, and you're going to count backwards. So this time you're counting backwards the ones. Because obviously they're transferring their knowledge from a written number line where they would be counting backwards. So it's just mirroring this onto this. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And then again you'd label the jumps. And the answer is the last one you land on. Similarly, when you've got two digits, Again, it relies on your knowledge of being able to count backwards in tens, which is why that's so important. So you're jumping back two lots of tens, and then the eight. And again, labelling that. And then, if I just show you the quarter, I'll show you doing column subtraction. So again, we do the tens and the ones. So again, with this one, we talk through starting at the ones, as always. And what I found, and even recently in year two, we're doing a lot of six take away one. So, which is a common misconception, of course, because they see the one, six in the one, and they think, oh, it's five in there. Because with addition, you can do it in any order, and that's what we emphasise, but with subtraction, you can't. You have to start with the bigger number. Obviously, the bigger number's on the top, so it's one, and then I physically get the, you know, one, one. You've got one, one. Can you take away six? No, you can't. We used to say, knock on the door of the tens and borrow one, but you're not actually borrowing it because you're taking it. You're never giving it back. So, you're taking it. So you're crossing out that. The three tens, and again we would have done all of this practical beforehand, which leaves only two tens. The ten that you've taken has to go over to the ones, but then don't forget the one that you've already got there. So what we tend to do is to cross that one out and then put this one as a whole number here rather than the little one there, so the children can really see that they've taken the whole lot over and added that. And then at this point, 11 ones take away 6 ones. Can we do that? Yes, we can. And then we do the tens the same way. Two tens take away one ten is one ten. So that is how we do addition and subtraction. Multiplication and division is pretty much what we do in year one, which is talking about sharing, talking about drawing pictures, and talking about how to do arrays and things like that. By the end of Key Stage 1, so by the end of Year 2, they only need to know their 2s, 5s and 10 times table, but also to be able to count in 3s. So, if they know their 2s, 5s and 10 times table off by heart, then a lot of what they do, they should be able to work it out. Because the trouble is, we won't teach them the short method for division and multiplication, so we don't teach them column method or, you know, the sort of division with the box, they call it the short division, because that is too complicated. So, for example, division, if I had 12 divided by 3, I would start off with, I could have 3 groups, and then I share out 12. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. How many in each group? 4. So I know that my answer is 4. Similarly, what I found recently though with children is if they've got that on there, 90 divided by 10. So they're sitting there trying to divide 90 dots out, which obviously isn't an efficient method. So, if they know their 10 times table, they know how many 10s are in 90. So this is how we work, you know, we use our multiplication facts to help us. So if they know their multiplication and division families really well, then they'll know that there are 9 tens in 90. Wouldn't even need to work that out. But if they do, it's down to pictures really, which does take quite a long time. And then, the multiplication is, we talk about arrays. So if I say 4 times 2, so that's 4 lots of 2, 4 multiplied by 2, and we can talk about, that's 1 lot of 2, that's another lot, 2, 3, 4. and then we count how many there are in total. But again, having that knowledge of twos, fives and ten times table will really, really help the children. Is there any questions about the strategies that I've used? Yes. There wouldn't be a sum like that in SAS. But what I would do for some children is I would look to see the connection between how many threes are there in nine, how many threes are there in six, and work it out that way. Yeah. Because we do always look at sort of patterns. There are questions that might be, for example, if you had... You wouldn't have a question like that, but there would be a word problem to suggest something like, how many sweets would I need to buy? How many, if packets of sweets came in two, or I had, well obviously the answer is two remains one, but they'd have to say round it up to three, you know, if there was a problem solving, but it would be in an actual problem. So a question might say, well, how many would they need to buy so that everybody got a sweet, for example, so they'd go, oh, well, it's more than two, but it's not quite three, but they'd have to round it up to three. But they wouldn't get a question where they have to then themselves put a remainder. Anything else about the strategies?
So what age do they learn multiplying table?
All of them, probably year four, I would have thought.
Yes, like when I was at school, that was so much.
Yeah. We don't stand up and go, you know, we're counting twos, we're counting fives, we're counting tens. But again, we don't go one times two is two, two times two, because that's the rote learning and that's what children get in their head. And then if I was to say to them, I think that there is a place for it. And I do think that children need to know it off by heart. But they also need to know what six times two is and apply it to a problem solving question. But no, in year two, the only times table questions they will have is twos, fives and tens, but they would need to see a pattern of counting in three. So there may be a question that says fill in the missing numbers and it's counting in three, but they wouldn't get a times table question for threes, fours or sixes or anything like that. So, in terms of the children's views, so I've been teaching maths for a very long time, and certainly since I've been here I've been maths lead, and I've done a lot of asking children about their views on maths, and children much prefer working with their peers. They really enjoy learning from each other. We've built up a real culture of learning partners in this school, and it works. It's lovely to see children explaining things to others. I've never seen maths so where children are so involved in what they're doing, especially because they're using practical things. If we see that they can do something, then you know we'll question them to further their learning. And they enjoy it. They love it. I have children that don't want to go out to play because they want to carry on doing maths. And since we've been doing maths, no problem. I don't have that so much with writing. But certainly with maths, they love it. And, you know, and they say maths can be fun, and it can be fun. And I think some of the things that I've learned over the years is that traditionally maths is always seen as hard, and children switched off completely from it. But actually it's not hard, it's that the concepts can be made easier by using smaller numbers, by using practical equipment. And as soon as children are hooked into that, then, you know, then they've got those basics to sort of make, you know, move their learning forward. So, the main things then, is to talk about things that you can do at home. Parents always say to me, what can we do at home? So we don't do worksheets and things like that anymore, because I do think one of the the main things about helping your children at home are doing the counting. As Mr. Jacob said, it can be from counting rhymes, it can be number wraps, you do doubles and halves, counting in, you know, from any given number. Telling the time, using a clock, using watches, using whatever it takes, both digital and analogue. You know, using those things. If I put the dinner on at 7:30, it takes half an hour, what time will it be ready? Lots of things like that in conversation. Money is a big one, and I told this story last year, and I've told my children, they thought it was hilarious, but when I was probably their age, I used to dress up as the Queen every Sunday and come for dinner. And my sister used to do the shopping list, and gravy was 2p, and salt and pepper was like 5p, and this, and I actually had to pay for my own dinner. But, you know, I kind of did that as a, it was almost like a fun, it was a role play thing, and it really, I remember it now as to really understanding that concept of money. And I think those kind of things are things like when you go shopping and finding the amount of things as well. Because we've just started our money topic today. And according to some children, a banana is about £50. And if you got a £50 note, you could actually tear some of it off and that could be a 50p. So you'll be amazed at what their concepts are. You know, we assume knowledge sometimes. We assume that, well, that surely they, you know this stuff, but they don't. And obviously, you know, it's our job to teach them. So it's those kind of things that really, really work. So I've kind of done a little handout of just things to keep doing with your children at home. Playing shops, get them to rage your purse, how much money have you got? I don't expect you to be sending your children to the shop like we probably did in our days, but, you know, giving them that when they're in a shop, even giving them 20p, can they find something that they could put on these days? Penny sweets don't exist, okay. Give them a pound. But you know what I mean. Using toys as tools to help with addition and subtraction. Get them to line their toy cars up, their teddies. You know, use lots of sort of practical things like that. Another thing is using a ruler and household items for measuring mass capacity, you know, looking at millilitres, kilograms, that kind of thing. Looking at fractions, that's another big area which their children traditionally find quite difficult. So halves, quarters, three quarters and thirds they need to know at the end of Key Stage 1. And recognising that two quarters is the same as a half. It's another thing that they need to do. So obviously you can see, and on this handout, so if you haven't got one, please take one. I gave the year two children one of these at the end, at the beginning of the year, but it's useful for everybody to see where the end goal is for the end of Key Stage 1. And you'll see that there's a huge amount to sort of cram in. Obviously not just in year two, you know, we start the ball rolling in FS, year one, and hopefully by year two this is the expected standard. And you know, it was the first year that we did the national curriculum last year, and it was challenging, you know, so obviously we need your support at home to continue doing what you can as well.